What a great day. What a great day to focus on the 99. The ways that we are the same, right? Not the ways that we're different. So we have been looking at five mirrors of the world, right? Men, mirrors, and magazines. And now we're going to talk about movie stars and the media. And we've learned today that when we look to the mirror of the world for our value, we can get a very confusing, right, and distorted sense of identity. We can get kind of a warped understanding of who we really are when we allow a man to define us, when we allow the image in the bathroom mirror to tell us who we are, because it's always changing, right? When we look to the magazines, we find out, my goodness, our body has no value, our body is our value. God is the straight shooter. God is not contradictory that way. But the world is. Looking at the fourth mirror of the world, the movie stars. You know, the movie stars are people too, right? They're just like us. When I think about Lady Gaga, you know, some of the other movie stars that are out there now, you know, Britney Spears and Rihanna, and a lot of women that are just as human as we are. We can't judge them because we know they're just like us, right? They've got the 99 going. They're made just like us. They're made to be daughters of the king. They're made to be his creation. But somewhere along the line, there's something's gotten distorted for some of them, not all of them. But these movie stars are just in our faces all the time, right? Angelina Jolie and Jennifer Aniston and all of their trials. And the world has a tendency to romanticize their pain, romanticize the adultery. Did you know the last seven women who have won Best Actress have all, at the time that they won the Oscar, their marriages have fallen apart, their relationships? And so many of them are such classy women, right? Reese Witherspoon, Sandra Bullock, Kate Winslet, Halle Berry, Julia Roberts, Hilary Swank, Charlize Theron. They're all very classy movie stars, and yet at the time that they won Best Actress, their relationships fell apart. And many children suffered from the divorce that ensued. There's an actress that I always respected. Her name is Uma Thurman. She was in the Yves Saint Laurent ads, you know, just absolutely striking, so beautiful. Well, when she went through her divorce, she was on the Oprah Winfrey Show, and I was watching it, and she said, I have no identity after her divorce. Isn't that sad? That the world is holding up this beautiful woman to be a movie star, but she herself is saying, I have no identity left. Basically that's saying, I don't even know who I am or what my value is. And yet, we are looking at the stars of the world, and they're just man, they're just people, for often a reflection of our own value. When we look to the movie stars to tell us what is beautiful, we often end up confused, right? Did you guys just catch that? I'm still klutzy. It's a good thing. Oh, this is so funny about that. I'm totally addicted to dark chocolate. And so on the break, of course, I have to have a dark chocolate. And my daughter always reminds me to read the little messages. And I always read them because I feel like it's a little message, you know, whatever. It'll say like, smile, or, you know, whatever. And today I got this one. It's okay to be fabulous and flawed. So fun. What a cool thing. Okay, so we're looking at the movie stars, right? But what happens when we turn and we look into the mirror of God? You know, the issue of pride in your outward appearance, right? Making everything look beautiful from the outside in is addressed biblically. God really has an opinion about this, and he goes into it in Isaiah 3, verse 16. And in this case, the Lord is talking about women who profess to worship him. He calls them the women of Zion. They were the women of God in that day. How many of you consider yourself to be a woman of God? Oh, I am in the company of the daughters of the King. What an honor. What an honor. Here in Isaiah 3:16, the Lord says, the women of Zion are haughty. Like they're hotties. And they know it. He goes, they are haughty. That means prideful. He's like, those women, he's talking about his women. He's like, the women of Zion are haughty. They're walking along with outstretched necks. They're flirting with their eyes. They're tripping along with mincing steps, with ornaments jingling on their ankles. Therefore, the Lord will bring sores on the heads of the women of Zion. Boy, did he do that to me. The Lord will make their scalps bald. Woo. Verse 18, in that day the Lord will snatch away their finery, the bangles and the headbands and the crescent necklaces, the earrings and the bracelets and the veils, the headdresses and the ankle chains and the sashes, the perfume bottles and the charms, the signet rings and the nose rings. Uh-oh. He just ripped that nose ring right out of the daughter's nose there. He says, I'm going to take it all off. You're haughty. You think that stuff makes you pretty? Do you think that's your value? He gets all upset. He says, I'm going to take away the fine robes and the capes and the cloaks, the purses and the mirrors, the linen garments and the tiaras and the shawls. He's going to take away all their pretty things. Why does he do that? We saw how he adorned the daughter. He clearly loves to lavish us with jewels and beautiful clothes and gifts and blessings. He clearly loves to love us like that. Why would he go clean out our closet? He says, instead of fragrance, there will be a stench. Instead of a sash, a rope. Instead of well-dressed hair, baldness. Instead of fine clothing, sackcloth. Instead of beauty, branding. Woo! He's opinionated. He's very opinionated about women who just think they are all that. Women who think, and we've all been there at times, that it's the adornments in the closet that give you value. It's not the outfit that gives you value. The treasure in the jar of clay, the spirit within us is what gives us power. It's what gives us beauty. 1 Peter 3, 3 through 5 says, your beauty should not come from outward adornment, such as the way you wear your hair or expensive jewelry or fine clothes, but your beauty is that of the inner self, the gentle and quiet spirit, which is so powerful in God's sight. The beauty within is the power. That's where the power lies. That's where the power comes from. Psalm 50 verse 2 says that God was perfect in beauty. Perfect in beauty. People followed Jesus around everywhere he went. Everywhere he went. But you know what the truth is? He was not even good looking. He was not even good looking. Right? Isaiah 53 shows that. It says, Isaiah 53, verse 2, he had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. Isn't that amazing? People followed Jesus everywhere he went, and yet he had nothing, no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. He didn't look like a movie star. Looked nothing like Brad Pitt. Nothing in his outward appearance. Nothing that would attract people to him. And yet, hordes of people followed him wherever he went. How could that be? It says that on the cross, in Isaiah 52, 14, that when he was on the cross, breaks my heart, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any man, his form marred beyond human likeness. When he was dying on the cross, he was so broken, so beaten, and so marred that you didn't even recognize him as human. It says that people hid their faces from him. They couldn't even look at him. It was so painful to see the brutality. Jesus was not good looking on the outside, but he had a beauty of the heart. Real beauty begins in the heart, and it spills out in our behavior. One of my favorite verses, Proverbs 11:22, I think, it says that a beautiful woman with no discretion is as pretty as a pig with a ring in its snout. There's another, the Message translation of that verse says that basically, if you're pretty on the outside, but you're empty on the inside, you're like that ring in a pig's snout. I mean, it's a beautiful face and an empty head. God is saying, you know what? That's just not beautiful to me. It's not beautiful to me to be pretty on the outside but ugly within. That's ugly to me. Why? Because 1 Samuel 16:7 says that the Lord does not look at the things that man looks at, right? The man looks at the heart. I got that wrong. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord sees the heart. It's great to be flawed and fabulous. Love it. It's my new thing. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord sees the heart. That's why Jesus could be not good looking on the outside, but Psalm 50 verse 2 says he was perfect in beauty. See, he had a perfect beauty of the heart, and people followed him because of his beauty in the heart. That's where his power was. That's where his majesty was. That's where his wisdom was. It was all in the heart. Pride in outward beauty began with the devil himself. Ezekiel 28, verse 12. In these verses, God is describing the enemy of our souls, Lucifer. Ezekiel 28, verse 12, the sovereign Lord says to Lucifer, "You were the model of perfection." The model of perfection. He's describing not Jesus, Satan. He says, "You were full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone adorned you, and you should study, you should read." Please do the Bible study. Read the Bible study. Study the enemy a little bit with me here so that we know, so that we can recognize his lies. He says, "You were the model of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty." This is God talking to Satan. "I created you. You were in the garden of God with me. Every precious stone adorned you." And those verses go on to describe the stones that he adorned the enemy with. Rubies and topazes and emeralds and jasper and crystallite and onyx and all. Literally, God adorned Satan with the most amazing, beautiful jewels in heaven. He was full of wisdom. He was perfect in beauty. He was wealthy, wealthy in heavenly terms, wealthy. But it goes on in Ezekiel 28, verse 17, that the Lord then says, "But your heart became proud. Your heart became proud on account of your beauty, and you corrupted your wisdom because of your splendor." He says, "Man, I gave you so much, but that pride, you wanted to be worshiped." At the beginning of Ezekiel 28, it says, "In the pride of your heart, you say, 'I am a God. I sit on the throne of a God in the heart of the seas.'" That's the way Satan looked at it. He was like, "I am a God. I sit on the throne of a God in the heart of the seas. I am a God. Worship me. Look at me. Look at me. Look at me. Reminds me of the runway. I was once his daughter. I know his ways. Look at me. Worship me. The pride of my heart. I sit on the throne in the heart of the seas." Right? And then what happens in Ezekiel 28, verses 18, God says, "So I made a fire come out from you, and it consumed you, and I reduced you to ashes on the ground." in the sight of all who are watching. And then he says, you have come to a horrible end and will be no more. And we know that he was destroyed, right? He was crushed underfoot as God crushed his son on the cross. So the enemy of our souls was crushed. He says, I'm going to reduce you to ashes. Pride in external beauty comes from the pit of hell. Pride in outward wealth comes from the pit of hell. Pride in wisdom actually also comes from that. And that's a lie that I really believed. I was a straight A student. I was academic scholarship. I was, you know, runway, doing the modeling thing. I totally believed that my outward, quote unquote, beauty as the world defines it and my outward intelligence or something gave me worth. But that's not true. It is in the face of God that I find my worth. It is in the reflection of his face that I see my true reflection. In his face, I see that I am his beloved daughter, flawed, but fabulous, flawed. Fabulous. I am his beloved daughter, and so are you. You know, in the face of him, you see that you are his precious creation, no matter what the world says, and you see that you are his temple. But for Jesus, beauty doesn't come outside in, it comes inside out. And we see that in Matthew 17, the transfiguration. Love this. In Matthew 17, it says that Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John. I have a rope of three cords praying for us today. I have a Peter, James, and John. They're not here. They're approaching the throne room as we speak. They're my prayer guard everywhere I go. Everyone needs a prayer guard. Everybody needs a Peter, James, and John. Who are yours? Think about that today. Who do you go with to meet with God? Who do you go with to seek his face? So Jesus goes up with Peter, James, and John, and it says he led them up to a high mountain by themselves. So as he is on the high mountain, it says there he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun and his clothes became as white as light. So he goes up to the mountain with the guys, and literally as he's up there, his beauty comes inside out. And his glory comes, and it's so bright. Other versions say that his clothes became so dazzling white that all the bleach in the world could never bleach him that white. And it, literally, his beauty didn't come outside in. It came inside out. It's like God took the seam of the flesh and turned it inside out, and his glory just shone. And it... obviously, Peter and James and John were so freaked out, I think they passed out and went to sleep. They didn't even know what to do with it. Beauty with Jesus comes from the inside out. It doesn't come from the outside in. Same goes for us. Who are movie stars? Let's ask ourselves those simple questions. Number one, who are movie stars? Romans 3:23 says that all fall short of the glory of God. They're just people, right? Isaiah says that all men are like grass. Their glory is like the flower of the field, right? Their glory rises and it falls because the breath of the Lord blows on them. I mean, a man's glory will rise. People have their time in the limelight and then it falls. And, you know, we're from dust we came, from dust we will return. They're here one day, they're gone the next, just like us. It's the same with us. All fall short of the glory of God. You try to turn inside out and blow us away with dazzling white. None of us can do that. We all fall short. We all fall short of the glory of God. All of us. All of us. They're just people. And what happens when we worship them? When we worship the stars of the world? Fascinating. Romans 1:21 says that when you exchange the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal man, your foolish hearts become darkened. Romans 1:21. So when we exchange the glory of the immortal God for images to look like man, for these kinds of images, the more we look at the images, the more our foolish hearts become darkened. Fascinating. We are in one of the darkest generations, one of the darkest times there has ever been. Right? We've got women cutting, girls killing themselves. One of the first translations of my book was in Korea. And I thought that was very interesting that it was going to go to Korea. It was great. It's being translated into Korean. Okay, so I'm talking to the Korean publisher, and she says, oh, every single girl in Korea needs to read this book. And I was like, really? Okay, great. I said, why? And she said, because they're all being told they have to look like Heidi Klum, and they never can. They can't get there, obviously, right? And so they think that they have to be Barbie to be loved, and so they're committing suicide over it. They're killing themselves over it. They want different eyelids and different, you know. Isn't it sad? What happens is when we look to those images of the world for a reflection of our value, Romans 1:21 through 23 says then that our foolish hearts become darkened and we become confused and we turn even on our own selves. And that's what those books out there are about from Mercy Ministries, about the addictions and about the pain of sexual abuse and alcoholism and all of those things, because we turn on our own selves. Okay, but in light of that, who is God? Who is God? If movie stars are just man, okay, we find out who we are in the light of who God is. Who is God? Revelations 22:16, Jesus says, I, Jesus, am the bright morning star. I'm the star, Jesus says. John 8:12, he says, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. He says, you know what, honey, if you follow me, you'll never walk in darkness. Don't follow images made to look like mortal man, right? Dancing with the stars and all that, is that really a definition of a star? He says, I am the bright morning star. That is who I am. If you follow me, you'll never walk in darkness. You'll have the light of life. What happens then when we turn away from the mirrors of the world and we instead worship the bright morning star? What happens? 2 Corinthians 4:6 says that God will make his light shine in our hearts. So we look at these stars, darkness, because we're worshiping a false image. We look at this star, the one that's eternal, that we cannot see. He fills our hearts with light. Who doesn't want that? Don't we all want that? If we're willing. Remember that the bleeding woman told Jesus the whole truth. And I think a lot of us hold back our truth, that there are things within us that hurt. There are areas that we really don't want God to go. You know what, God? I want to go to a women's event. I really do, but I really don't want you to go there. I don't really want to deal with my molestation today. I got to go to the grocery store later, and I don't want to really deal with my marriage today. Or, you know what, if you're going to try to shine a light in that place of my heart, I closed that door a long time ago. Or maybe he wants to deal with the alcohol, the drugs. Maybe he wants to deal with, you know, same-sex infatuations that you're feeling. I don't know. But what I do know is that when we worship the bright morning star, he wants to shine a light in everything in our hearts so that he can heal us and clean us and make us whole. So when we worship him, he fills our hearts with light. And you know, 1 John says that perfect love drives out fear. We shouldn't be afraid to come before him unmasked. We shouldn't be afraid to come before him unveiled. When he died on the cross, the veil of the temple was torn in two, ripped from top to bottom. That means that we can now enter into the most holy place, the sacred place, just us and God. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says that when we come to him unveiled, unmasked, he transforms us to be more like him, glory to glory. We become more and more beautiful from the inside out. There should be no fear to just lay your heart out. Lay your heart out to God. Who are we in light of who he is? If he is the light of the world, he is the bright morning star. Who are we? Philippians 2:15 says that we are children of God in a crooked and depraved generation, in which we are to shine like stars in the universe as we hold out the word of life. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. You are the light of the world. You are the light of the world, he says to you today. That's who you are. You look at my light, you'll reflect my light. If you're real, if you go unveiled and get rid of your mask. And I can really go deep with you. I'll fill your heart with light and you can become a light to the world. Who are we? In Philippians 2:15, it says we're to shine like stars in the universe. I love that. We're the stars. We're the stars. The book of Daniel says that those that lead others to righteousness will shine like the stars forever and ever. We will shine like the stars forever and ever. Us. Now, I don't mean you to go back to your school, girls, and be like, I am a movie star. But you can hold it in your heart and go, I'm the light of the world. It's actually not Rihanna. It's actually not Jennifer Aniston. It's me. It's me. I am the light of the world. Those who lead others to righteousness will shine like the stars forever and ever. Can we even grasp that? Can we even imagine that? It's amazing. We are his shining stars. And how do we do that? We hold out the word of life. A good example is in Acts chapter 3 of some Christians, some disciples, holding out the word of life, shining like stars in the universe. Love this story. Acts chapter 3, verse 1. We've got Peter and John on their way to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon. 3 o'clock prayer meeting. Time to go. Okay? Peter and John are on their way to the temple. They're going in. But there's a man crippled from birth who was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful. Interesting name for that temple. The temple gate was called Beautiful, and there he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple court. So every day this guy would go and put out his cup, right? And he would beg. And then it says that when Peter and John were about to enter, they just blew right by him because they didn't want to be late for their meeting. No. It says that when Peter and John were about to enter, the beggar asked him for money, and Peter looked straight at him. Now, sometimes I think we are so busy, us women, that we are just going from thing to thing to thing to thing. You know, actually, the first person who reached out to me for Christ was, I met her the weekend that I had gotten my backpack stolen from me. And I met her in Italy. And I met her because I got my backpack stolen, so I was traveling without a bag for a while. And I checked into this hostel. I did some really tacky runway shows in Rome, and then I checked into this hostel and decided that I was gonna just be a normal girl for a little while. And I met this girl at the hostel there. This is before I went back to Germany or anything. I was still in Italy. I'd prayed once that God would show himself to me. And the thing that I remember about this girl is that she looked me in the eyes. You know, I was the beggar. I was holding out my cup. And God put one woman in my life. I remember she looked me in the eyes when she met me. She started asking me questions about my life. And she said to me, how is your life going? You know, she took the time. And I remember telling her that, you know, I'm having a hard time out here and things like that. And she was so kind to me. And she said to me that I needed to have a relationship with Jesus and that I should read the Bible. And I didn't receive it at the time. I was like, oh, that's okay. I do yoga. I did. I meditate. I pray. She's all, who too? And I'm like, well, angels? I don't know. I mean, I did not know. And she explained the blood of Christ to me and everything. And she told me that she was going to pray for me. And then it was a few weeks later that I moved to Munich and tried to kill myself and then met those people in the park. And I don't know who that woman was. And I have never seen her since. And she doesn't know anything about my ministry now. But what an amazing thing. And those people I met in the park who took the time to talk to me and to believe that there were people in the world that have not heard the gospel. Here's the truth. Jesus isn't back because there are still people that don't understand the good news. There are still people who need to receive the good news. And so, as the beggar is at the temple gate called Beautiful, Peter and John look straight at him, and I love this. They say to him, "Look at us." They look the man face to face, eye to eye. It says the man then gave him his attention, expecting to get something from him. So he's just looking up like, what? You know, you guys are going to drop a coin in my cup. And Peter says to him, "Silver or gold, I do not have." That's totally me. I'm in the ministry. I don't have any money to give you people. I'm in the ministry. Right? I don't make a lot of money doing this. They're like, "Silver or gold, I do not have." Like, I'm not going to give this man money. What I'm going to give him is what I got. And in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. So they give him what they've got. Are you given what you got? I've got Jesus, and I'm giving it out. Are you doing that? I'm not saying, are you a speaker? I'm saying, are you given what you got? What do you have? And if you have Jesus, you got to give what you got. It says they take him up by the right hand and help him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles become strong. He jumps up and he begins to walk, and he goes around the temple courts just praising God and causing all kinds of commotion. I mean, the whole story goes on for chapters. Peter and John get in so much trouble. They get called before the authorities. They're telling him not to speak in Jesus' name. I mean, the whole story keeps going, and it all started with the beggar at the temple gate called Beautiful. That they weren't so busy, that they could see the loss, they could see the suffering. And many of you are in ministry, that you are reaching the suffering, you are reaching the lost. And I speak truth and life and power over your ministries and power over you right now. That is what it's all about. Don't get so busy that you miss the beggar at the temple gate. I used to be the beggar, and now I'm Peter and John. Now I'm Peter and John. Actually, I'm just Peter, she's John. Travel 2x2. James is in the back. We travel with a team. We're a team of women, and we're doing ministry in the name of Jesus. Are you with me today? That Jesus is coming back. He's coming back. Those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like stars forever and ever. Who are we? We are his stars. We are the stars. It's us. Flawed but fabulous. John. The book of John. Fifth mirror of the world. The final mirror. Here we go. The media. The media is way too big for me or you. It's mass forms of communication. It's wonderful in many ways, right? Girls in Germany can download my videos from their website, right? They can read my story. They can connect with me. They can write. You know, it's cool. It's neat. I mean, because of the media, because of Facebook, and because of the internet and all those things, we can reach places in the world that we never could before. So there's a lot of power there. There's obviously a lot of power for evil, okay? The media, the internet specifically, has made sex slavery, sex trafficking, a piece of cake. Piece of cake. Right? A pedophile can just go online and order himself a boy. And that is the darn truth. He can order himself up with your daughter if you are not guarding her. Proverbs 4:23 says, "Guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life." Are you guarding your heart on the internet? Are you just posting whatever's on your mind? I kind of have a pet peeve about this, but when I go on Facebook and I see other Christian girls and, you know, women going, "My coffee maker broke this morning, I'm so bummed." I'm like, Jesus is coming soon. Are we really going to announce that to the world? I'm seriously, like, I'm going to bed, that's the truth that you want to impose upon my heart today, I don't care. Nobody cares when you're going to bed. Good night. Nobody cares. Nobody cares. Nobody. If we're going to be a light to the world, can we please have something to say? Can we please say something? Don't say anything. Don't just talk. Don't just chit-chatter. Nobody cares. Go practice piano. Go read a book. Go do something to manifest your gifts and talents. Don't waste your time with the chitter-chatter. Time is short. Behold, I am coming soon, he said. Will you have your lamp lit? Are you being a light to the world? It's a challenge for all of us because Facebook can just totally distract us. Huh? But by the way, go ahead and friend me because I'll totally accept your request. Okay. I'm looking for friends. No, just kidding. What is the media? The media is a creation of man. A creation of man, that's all it is, okay? It's not man that's the problem. Man created the printing press originally to print the word of God. What did man do with it? He printed pornography. It's not the printing press that's the problem. It's man. It's the things he does with his own creation. What is the nature of the media? Deceiving. The media is deceiving. It's also adversarial. Okay? Because that's why we see the bad news, the bad news, the bad news on TV all the time. The bad news, right? And it's deceiving because we think it's safe, but it's really not. We can allow people in our lives, you know, someone could easily post a photo and tell you that they're somebody, but they're really not that somebody. They're really not, right? And that's deceiving. God is not that way. He is not deceiving. He is a straight shooter. He told Eve exactly the consequences if she sinned. He's not double-sided that way. He doesn't post a photo and then behind it is a sicko. But you're gonna run into that, girls, on the media, on the internet. Don't be a fool. Don't allow your foolish heart to convolute and become darkened because you're allowing people into your life that have no business there. Be careful. Do not post photographs of your entire family and all this. I don't know. Be careful. Be careful. Be careful. I caution. I just want to caution. Right? Proverbs 4:23 says, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. And we guard our heart by guarding our families. We guard our heart by guarding our bodies. We guard our heart by guarding our privacy. If you have a breakup, if you have a pain, go talk to a counselor, somebody at church. Don't post it online. Be wise. Be wise. Finally, the things that we see on TV, all the shows we love, just let's just keep in step with the spirit. Okay, everybody, a lot of us love to watch The Bachelor. Who likes to watch The Bachelor? It's totally worship of man. Okay. It's entertaining. Project Runway, worship of beauty, Ezekiel 28. American Idol, did I hear that word again? Did I just say idol? American Idol, right? Worship of talent, love it. Love the show, love it. Just food for thought, right? Survivor. Who can be the best deceiver? Who can lie like a snake and win the money? CSI, murder. It's all about murder. Just realize that Satan is the father of lies. He's a murderer from the beginning. Let's know our enemy, okay? It's just wising up. Who is God? Samuel 7:28 says, O sovereign Lord, you are God. In light of all of this, in light of this fallen world, and it's a little bit like, I'm raising a lot of tough subjects, you know. In light of all of this, he is sovereign. There's no fear. Samuel 7:28 says that God is sovereign. That means he's paramount in authority. He's autonomous. He is paramount. He is supreme in authority over all of this, even the sex trafficking that is so rampant in the world. God is still paramount. He is still on the throne. He is not threatened by any of this. He is fully aware and in full authority. and he is going to come back for us. But in the meantime, what is our role with all of this? What do we do in this fallen world? Who are we in light of who he is? Who are we in light of his sovereignty? 1 Peter 2:9 says, but you are a chosen people. Who are we? Chosen. You're chosen. You're chosen. You are chosen. You were chosen to be here today. You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood. We have royalty, like Esther, called to such a time as this. A holy nation. We're holy. We're his temples. We're a people belonging to God. We're his daughters. We're in his family. Why? So that we may declare the praises of him who has called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light. He called me out of darkness. I would never go back. Please don't let me ever fall to go back. But we are called out of the darkness into his wonderful light because we are a chosen people. And 2 Corinthians 5:20 says, we are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. Who are you in light of a sovereign God? You are his representative. You are his diplomatic representative on earth. You are a chosen ambassador of the Most High God. This world is not your home. If you follow Christ, this world is not your home. We are here on a mission. We are here for a purpose. We're not here to chit-chat. We are not here to play games. We are here to save souls and bring them to the King of Kings on the final day. Are you there with me? Do we have purpose? Yes, we do. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, we do. Yes, ma'am. We've got purpose. And we've got position. And we've got authority. And our authority is this. It comes from the sovereign Lord. We're not threatened by the enemy. Get behind me, Satan. I've got work to do. We just received Christ with a girl on the way to the bathroom. Where are you? Where's the one? Right there. Right there. Go into the bathroom. Going to the bathroom. I'm on my way. I got my tank top on. She stops me in the hallway. Let's accept Jesus right now. Boom. Let's do it. Amazing. No glory to me. All the glory to God has nothing to do with me. It's just making ourselves available. Are you making yourself available? What can you do? What can you do that I can't do? You, I'm going to go home on Monday. You're going to be here in this community. What do people need in this community? Do they need you to share about your struggles, about how you survived adultery? Are you needing to be ministered to? Do you need to go in the prayer place and ask somebody to help you? Maybe you are way, way, way over me, and you are washing the feet of the lepers like Mother Teresa, and you are, oh my goodness, you're going to the darkest corners of the world and washing hungry children and giving them water. I don't know what you're doing, but you can do what I cannot. I can do this. What can you do? What can you do? What can you do for the daughters? That's what I want to know. Truly, Titus 2:4 says that the older women are to teach the younger. Why are our youth groups doing their youth thing and our women are doing their women's thing? What in the world? When are the daughters and the mothers getting together? Titus 2:4 says the older women are to teach the younger. Oh, there's such a charge on our lives. There's such a charge on your life. Join with the daughters. Join arm in arm with the younger generation. Older women, don't check out. We need you. Teach us how to love our husbands. Teach us how to care for our homes. Teach us how. You came from a very private generation. Speak into our lives on Facebook. Get on Facebook. Friend us. But then talk to us about it. Don't check out. It's not over yet. You've got such a charge on your life. We have so much to learn from you. All right. The first ambassador who was a woman was Mary Magdalene. John 20, verse 10. After, Mary Magdalene, we know, was healed from 7 demons. She was demon-possessed. She was racked with insecurities, loneliness, despair, disease, some kind of unexplained anxiety, that in her day, people didn't really know how to explain it, and so they just called it demon possession, because they didn't know what was really wrong with her. Still exists today. Mary Magdalene was demon possessed. Jesus drove out her seven demons and she followed him for the rest of her days. She wasn't married. She apparently had money because she provided for Jesus and his disciples on their journey as they traveled about. She went all the way to the cross. Most everybody fled. Most everybody left, right? The men, all of them except for John, all the disciples fled at the cross. It was too brutal. There was too much. It was too dangerous. It was too scary. Whatever, the women stayed. Mary, the mother of Jesus, we know Mary Magdalene was there. Joanna, there were a few other women there, but they stayed at the cross. So the women saw it. You know, they were there. They were there. They saw it. And then it says, afterwards, the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. So everybody went home to obey the Passover, and finally everybody went back home, and the Lord is gone now. I mean, her healer is gone. The lover of her soul, Song of Songs, he's gone. She cannot find him, and she is broken. She has no husband, no children. She had Jesus. Jesus became her Lord. He became her everything. She left everything to follow him. And now he was gone, crucified, not just gone, but murdered before her very eyes. Her heart was so in despair and so broken. When everybody went back to their home, she went to the tomb, and she was weeping at the tomb. And the Bible teaches here that she just stood outside the tomb, and she was just crying and crying. And as she wept, you know, she just looks into the tomb, and she's crying and crying. And then suddenly she sees these angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been inside the tomb, one at the head and one at the foot. And they asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" That was my husband's first memory verse. "Woman, why are you crying?" I'm sorry. Actually, his first one was flee from 1 Corinthians, flee sexual immorality. We were dating, and he wanted us to stay pure till we were married. And so he memorized the verse flee. And so he would be going to kiss me goodnight. We didn't want to be tempted to fall into sexual sin, and so he would just say flee and then leave. That was his first memory verse. His second one was, "Woman, why are you crying?" I don't know. I just cried. But anyway, so Mary is at the... She's at the garden. She's in the garden. Her heart is broken, and she's crying. And the angels say to her, "Woman, why are you crying?" And she comes back, "Because they've taken my Lord away. He was like all I had. Where is he? And I don't know where they put him. Where did he go? I don't know where they put him. Where did he go?" At this, she turned around and she saw Jesus standing there, but she didn't realize that it was actually Jesus. Jesus now says to her, he was the originator of this, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for?" She thinks he's the gardener. He is the gardener. It's totally the gardener, right? Eve in the garden, full circle. She thinks he's the gardener. "I'm looking for..." And he says to her, "Mary," like, "it's me." And she goes, "Rabboni." That means teacher. "Rabboni, teacher." He's risen. Right? And she reaches out to hold on to him, and Jesus says to her, "You do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them I'm returning to my Father." The first woman he gives the Great Commission to was just a messed up, crazy broad. Love it. Totally messed up in the head.
got cleaned up, followed Jesus, crying. She's a mess. But he says, he gives her the first great commission. Go instead, tell my brothers, tell them I'm returning to the Father and your Father, to my God and your God. And Mary and Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, I've seen the Lord, I've seen the Lord. And she told them that he had said these things to her. Of course, the guys don't even believe her. They're like, well, we'll go see for ourselves. The first one, crazy, messed up broad, flawed, but fabulous, right? What does she do? She goes and she tells. She goes and she tells. Women, go and tell. Go and tell the good news. Go and tell. There are so many people who still need to hear it. We are his chosen ambassadors. You know, this message means so much to me because I really believe it. Can you tell, I hope? I really believe it. I do. And I believe it straight from the throne room. And he just downloaded it into my heart. And I've wanted to share it more and more, and I believe it. But this last year, I began to pray for the Lord to make me more like him. Just all the time, like that song, make me more like you, Lord, make me more like you, make me more like you. And then I went through the most difficult year of my adult life. I had more pain, betrayal, heartache, tragedy, and disappointment in myself and others than I'd ever had in my entire life. Rejection, brutal, just brutal. We all have those seasons. I had the worst year and the worst tragedy. And it was the few days after that tragedy that I was sitting in church, like I was like, I'm just going to go to church. You know, I'm just going to go to church in the middle of this hurt. I'm going to go. My husband, take me, you know, and we go. And I was sitting there, and we have these identity bracelets out there that our ministries developed just to adorn the daughters and to remind them of their identity in Christ. And they say, you know, you are my beloved daughter, you're my precious creation, my holy temple, my shining star, my chosen ambassador. And they have the five symbols and the words. And I was sitting there looking down at the bracelet. We had just come out with it, and I was like, no, I'm not. I am not. Totally just broken. I'm not. You know, my life had just fallen apart in my eyes. And as I was thinking that, the pastor came up on the screen and he's got his point one, point two, point three, and point one is all I remember. And the words came up on the screen, your identity is more powerful than your brokenness. Your identity is more powerful than your brokenness. I want to speak that truth over you today if you are hurting. Your identity is more powerful than your brokenness. John 16:33 says that in this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. The one who is in us is greater than the one who is in the world. Jesus has overcome the world. He's not overcome by our brokenness. In fact, in our brokenness, he makes us more like him because he was broken. He was broken. Are you broken today? Have you believed lies? Have you hurt? We all do. We all do. We want to give you a chance this afternoon before everybody goes home to lay those lies to rest once and for all, to lay out your brokenness once and for all, to lay out what hurts. Maybe it's sin in the temple that you still haven't dealt with. Deal with it before you leave, my ladies. Deal with it before you leave. Go out a temple gate called beautiful. You are the temple. Jesus is the gate. He is the beauty. We are the light. But when we have sin all messed up inside of us, he can't reign. He doesn't want you just to call him Lord. He wants to be your Lord. He doesn't just want me to call him Lord. He wants to be my Lord. And that means utter submission,
utter submission to His holiness, His wisdom, His ways, keeping in step with the Spirit. I got to get out of the way. What do you have to get out of the way? What in your life is in the way? What's in the way of the light truly shining from you, of you truly being a light to the world and an ambassador? Because I am no more an ambassador than you are. I'm no more chosen than you are. I've got a sink full of dishes at home, a crying baby, there's going to be a ton of laundry, a family who loves me, you know, but the bottom line is, I'm just like you. 99. Right? The 99. You and I are 99% the same, and we all have stuff. We all have stuff that we have to lay at the foot of the cross. And so we're going to give you guys a chance. We have shredders up here in front of the room, and you all came in with a card. We're going to give you a chance just to write on your card maybe some lies that you've believed while we listen to some music and worship. We're going to just give you some time to just digest this for a moment. Writing your lies down, your sin, whatever is holding you back. The Word of God says that we're supposed to throw off everything that entangles us. What's entangling you? What's getting in the way? Behold, He is coming soon. Write it down. Come on up. Put it in the shredder, ladies. And leave it here. And then go back to your seat because we have a gift for you.
So, oh, how He loves us. So heaven meets earth like an unforeseen kiss. My heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about the way. Sitting, I invite you to sing these words out with us. It just says, you hold my every moment. God, you calm my raging seas. You walk with me through fire. You heal every one of my diseases.
Thank you. They've been amazing. A beautiful offering. As we give that sin that so easily entangles, he then wants to give us a gift. And the gift that we have for you this weekend is this sweet little bookmark that says, "You are more. You are more." So many women have come up to me and said that they believed that lie, that they weren't enough in some way, that they weren't enough. And this is the truth. You were created for impact. You are more. And if you have one already, I want you to flip it over because we're going to repeat this together. And if you don't, give a hand raised because they're going to pass out your gift for you in the aisles. They're going to go up and down the aisles and give you your gift. Yeah, raise your hand and we'll give it to you. As we do that, I just want to take a moment and say thank you so much again for coming out today. And thank you to Pat Simo, who put this day together for you. She did it. She did it. And the neat thing about that is that it was the voice of a woman in this church, in Willow. And it's neat to know that in a church this size, one woman has a voice. Isn't that awesome? You don't have to be on staff to have a voice. You can just be just who you are, and you have a voice. And I think that's amazing. That's wonderful. Okay, does everybody have their gift? Okay. We're going to say it together, okay, because I got news for you. This is your 100% the same identity. This is your 110% the same identity, you and me. Let's pass it on generation till generation. Lord, please do not forsake me until I am old and gray, till I have declared your power to the next generation. This is a generational identity from the throne room given to you as a gift. He is saying to you and to your grandmother and to your granddaughter and to future generations, this is no 99, baby. This is your 110. You are 110. I am God's beloved daughter. I am God's precious creation. I am God's chosen ambassador. I am God's holy temple. I am God's shining star. 110, baby. 110. That's who you are. All across the board, no man can give you that identity. No man can take that from you. Take it. Lay hold of it. Bless me back. Pass it on. Pass it on. If somebody had passed this on to me when I was young, my life could have been so changed. Older, pass to the next generation, teach them the kindnesses of the Lord. I have that in my life. And I just, before I'm done, I got to give a shout out. I have a wonderful mother in love. Her name is Linda, and she's not here, but she's at home probably giving Samuel a bath. She's probably baking cookies with Olivia and Zach. And my husband's there. That's my blessing, that when I'm out of town, my husband's at his mother's house. Because she can really cook. We're a team. But I have learned from the older generation what it is to truly be beautiful by watching them show me beauty from the inside out. And it's our calling to teach it to our daughters. This is who you are. Pass it on. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, let's really thank Jennifer for her time.